Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Nancy Birdsall. There are a few of you I don't know. Ed, you have brought out an amazing crowd. That's my first impression. I'm the president of the Center for Global Development, and it's a great delight for me to have a chance to open this event. In some sense, for CGD, I could say we're coming to the end of an era, but it's really not the end of an era. It's really just a transition we're going through, an important one, though. Many of you will know that Ed Scott, who is a co-founder and the founding chair and the initial generous benefactor that made CGD possible. We would not be here today without what he did. Ed, several months ago, indicated that he would like to step down as the chair of the board. And subsequently, our board unanimously elected Larry Summers to be our next chair. Today is March 25th, and we're hearing today from Ed Scott. We're coming to that in a few moments. On April 25th, the day of our board meeting, we will have a public event, a luncheon starting at 12:30, when we will hear from Larry Summers. Ed will introduce Larry Summers, and that will be the moment of transition. My job today is not to talk about Ed, which is hard, but to introduce to you the person who will introduce Ed. And that person is Ruth Levine, who is very well, I'm going to get a little teary. Ruth is, I think of Ruth as my in-house co-conspirator in realizing the vision that Ed has had of what CGD should be. She's the co-conspirator in thinking about it, but more important, she is the one who actually showed us at CGD in the early days how to do it. She's not only the visionary with Ed, but the implementer. Two of our home runs were led by Ruth Levine. One was the advanced market commitment, and the other the creation through a working group that Ruth managed of the International Initiative for Impact Evaluation. Ruth joined CGD in April 2002, so that was within 5 months of when I started working at CGD. So believe me, she was there at the founding, and whatever DNA we have that we all like and think is good, I credit very much to Ruth Levine. She also invented the idea of the working group, and I encourage those of you who haven't seen it to read an essay that Ruth did with Lawrence McDonald. What's it called, Lawrence? 12 lessons?
Learning while doing.
Learning 12-step program for policy change. Ruth is now the director of the Global Development and Population Program at the Hewlett Foundation. She was stolen away from CGD a few years ago in order to become the Deputy Assistant Administrator for Policy Planning and Learning at USAID. I'm not sure if Ruth said, I want it to be called Policy Planning and Learning. Ruth, you have the floor. Thank you for joining us.
Ed, you know you're important when the introducer gets an introduction. It is a huge pleasure to have been invited to introduce Ed Scott. Along with all of you, I'm looking forward to hearing some straight talk from someone who's made a huge positive difference in the world over many years. Ed has changed the world by giving generously, and he's also changed the world by setting really high expectations for impact. I know this very personally. Years ago, when CGD was in its toddlerhood, Ed absolutely terrified me. And he terrified me because he asked the question, how would my work on global health policy save babies in the next year? And that is a question that, despite the fact that I'd worked on projects for USAID, I'd worked at the World Bank, I'd worked at the Inter-American Development Bank, that is the sort of question that no one had ever asked. I had never been pressured, demanded to think about how the analytic work, how the careful studies, how the reports would add up to something important in the world. That question deserved a really good answer. And seeking that answer fundamentally changed me from a write a good report person to try to make a big difference person. And that is an irreversible switch. I'm guessing that the expectations that we heard from Ed, destabilizing as they were at many times to our wonky world, had the same effect on many of my former colleagues here. It's a motivation, I think, for much of the work that the Center for Global Development does, and particularly for the initiatives, the kind of time-bound efforts to marshal a whole set of disciplinary expertise against a big but solvable problem. And remarkably, Ed's high expectations about impact, which CGD has lived up to under Nancy's leadership every day of every year, were paired with a really healthy separation from the day-to-day decisions. Ed is one of those rare individuals who can place a bet and wait to see whether it pays off. Far more than many others seem to be able to do, he lets go. And as he does, the institutions that he supports go further and higher than they would if he held on tight. You have Ed's bio, so I won't attempt to recount all of his remarkable career, except to note that CGD is only one of several successful organizations that Ed has created to make the world a better place. He's what the world needs a lot more of, a serial social entrepreneur. So I'll mention just four of these organizations, and I know there are folks in the room who have contributed to the success of all of them. Ed is the co-founder, along with Bill Gates and George Soros, of Data, now morphed into One, an advocacy organization dedicated to building public and political awareness about development problems in Africa. He's the founder and chairman emeritus of the Friends of the Global Fight, which, with the assistance of the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, provides support and advocacy in the U.S. for the Global Fight Fund to fight AIDS, TB, and malaria. He's the founder of the Center for Interfaith Action on Global Poverty, which seeks to improve the capacity and effectiveness of faith-based faith-based community in its collective effort to reduce global poverty and disease. He has also, I'm really not done yet, he has also established and funded the Scott Family Fellows Program, which provides the president of Liberia a cadre of highly trained economists and development specialists who work directly for the cabinet secretaries of various Liberian ministries to help reconstruct that country. His recent business ventures include Stitcher, an online radio app, which Lawrence McDonald says he uses, and Spreecast, a social video platform. And he also has recently started working with a biofuels venture to turn tobacco into diesel. There you go. After Ed speaks, he'll be joined on stage by David Callahan, the founder of Inside Philanthropy, a dynamic new digital media enterprise that's shaking up reporting about the business of giving. Let me just say at the Hewlett Foundation, we're not worried about this. We welcome it. David recently wrote that Ed is the most effective global giver in Silicon Valley. David will interview Ed and then open to questions from the floor, and we hope there are some tough ones. So now please join me in welcoming somebody who makes a big difference in the world by doing things differently, Ed Scott.
Well, I'm your biggest fan, Ruth. What Nancy didn't tell you is Ruth wrote a book called Millions Saved that those of you in this audience who have not read it need to read it. It is the best example of how people can really do real stuff to get real things done to fight poverty and global and to improve global public health. Thank you, Nancy, and thank you, Ruth. On occasions like this, people always talk about how honored they are. And I truly am honored to see every seat filled up in a day when it's snowing like crazy, or even if it weren't snowing like crazy. It's truly humbling. And if you're a person who goes through your life sort of not feeling very worthy, it's very touching indeed. CGD is a great institution, and I'm very proud to have been part of its creation and to have had a front row seat to observe its growth and its reach and its impact over the years. But nobody's more responsible for that success than my steadfast colleague, Nancy Birdsall. Her leadership, her sensibility, and her intellectual vision have made CGD what it is. Thank you very much, Nancy. And I wonder if I could ask all of you to give Nancy a tremendous. It's characteristic on occasions like this for people to acknowledge people who've come, and I'm going to do that as well. First, Heather, my daughter, sitting up here in front. Heather's a reporter for an organization called Market News, and I'm really pleased she could make it here today. My financial counselor and financial conscience, Barbara Carlisle, has come all the way from California. Her plane didn't get in till 2 in the morning last night, so it was quite a sacrifice for her to be here. And most importantly, my wife, Cheryl, who has been along for the entire trip and has been not only supportive of my various philanthropic ventures, but also has contributed intellectually in many, many different ways. And I thank you for that. The only negative that I ever got from Cheryl was every once in a while, she would say, "Are we in danger of running out of money?" And I would tell her no, and then I'd say, "Geez, am I right?" And there are two people here in spirit, but not physically present, who I'd like to acknowledge. One is my son, Reese, who's in Tokyo at the moment. Reese graduated last summer from St. Anthony's, Oxford, and is now in Tokyo and hoping to get into the high-tech industry there. Reese used to come to many, many CGD events, and the important people would say important things, and then it would come question time, and a couple people, and then Reese would raise his hand. And I used to just cringe when that happened because I'd say, "What is Reese going to say? And is he going to embarrass himself?" And I would just hold on to the side of the table, and Reese would get up, ask his question, and it would be surrounded upon it. And then I would say to myself, "Why didn't I think of that?" So Reese has had an understanding and a perceptive insight into what CGD does since he was 13 years old. And I couldn't love him and be more proud of him. And the other person who's here in spirit, I'm sure, is Carol Lancaster. Carol recently had the bad fortune to have a very, very serious health crisis, and she's now recovering slowly. But Carol was very much part of the group that shaped the concept of CGD. And she was on the original board. She's written a couple books under the CGD banner, and she's just a terrific person. And I hope that someone who talks to Cheryl next, to Carol next, will pass on my best wishes, and I hope all of you will pray for her recovery. Anyway, I've had the occasion to be invited to speak at commencements twice, and I've asked for advice about what you should say when you do that, and people usually say something like, be humorous and be brief. So it seems to me that that advice you'd expect that advice to apply to farewell speeches. And yet I think about George Washington and Douglas MacArthur, and they apparently didn't get the memo, because they certainly weren't brief and they certainly weren't very humorous either. But then they were addressing joint sessions of Congress, and so recognizing that this is not a joint session of Congress, I'll try to keep profundity to a minimum. And by the way, Ed, you're no George Washington or Douglas MacArthur. Anyway, even though I'm certainly a person of very modest standing, CGD has become an institution of considerable distinction. You can tell that by the company it keeps. We've had visits at CGD from the Secretary General of the UN, Ban Ki-moon, Jim Kim, the President of the World Bank, Tony Blair, Hillary Clinton, Ernesto Zedillo, Jakaya Kikwete, the President of Tanzania, Morgan Tsvangirai, the former Prime Minister of Zimbabwe, Ellen Johnson Sirleaf, whose speech was so moving she got me to collaborate with Steve Bradlett to do the Fellows Program, and Festus Mohai, the former president of Botswana. I took great pleasure at meeting President Mohai because he brought his entire cabinet with him, and he and virtually all of them to a person had gone to University College, Oxford, my college, by the way. We had quite a bond in the room at that time. We have had on our board three secretaries of the U.S. Treasury, and one of those will become the new chair of CGD, and we couldn't be more fortunate. So how did we get here anyway? And I can tell you're all saying, oh God, he's gonna tell the story of how CGD came into being again. And I am. And the reason is because I asked Lawrence McDonald if I should, and he said, yes, I definitely should. So if you're bored and hate it, blame him. Anyway, how did CGD get to be here? Well, first, you know, financial good fortune struck me as a founder of a company called BEA Systems. And once you've, you know, bought everybody a house and bought yourself a house and done a few other extravagant and stupid things, you realize that, you know, that if you have the good fortune to come into considerable wealth, that there's a true responsibility that comes with that. And once you get that, then you start to think about how should you discharge that responsibility. And at the beginning, you know, I was involved in a lot of relatively put your toe in the water, small time kinds of charitable activities. But one night at about 3 a.m, I was watching television and I saw a TV piece on debt in the developing world and what a burden it was and how it had an extremely corrosive impact on what went on in the developing world. And so I became obsessed with the issue, and I had a woman named Christina Bechtold, who had worked at BEA, who's a tremendous researcher, Stanford MBA, do a bunch of research on the whole issue of debt. And then she introduced me to a guy named Don Abramson, who was the head of the World Jewish Relief and had been involved very much in the what's the name of the debt? Jubilee campaign. And Don said, you should go to Washington and meet these people who were involved with Jubilee and, you know, get the benefit of their thinking. So I trotted off to Washington, even though, for those of you who know me, I spent 17 years in this town as a bureaucrat, so I knew a little bit about how the place operated. But anyway, they sponsored this meeting at Oxfam, and at the meeting was Carol Lancaster and Tim Geithner and Gene Sperling and Princeton Lyman and Jerry Flood and Joe Marie Griesgraber, all of whom are known to many of you. And they obviously had conspired to figure out how they would separate Ed from his money. And they did a very good job. Gene Sperling led the crew and basically made the point that, Ed, it's not all about debt. It's about other stuff. And he listed some of the other stuff. And he was quite persuasive. And so as I thought about it, I thought, well, we ought to have, he said, you know, when we were in the White House, the Clinton administration had just turned over, we frequently had questions about development, and we had nowhere to turn. We had no one who really had the authoritative answer. And an institution that could provide that would be a tremendous thing for the world. So I thought, that sounds like very good advice, and I set out in my mind to construct what that would look like. And I asked them, who should I get advice from? And they said, Fred Bergsten, who ran a thing called IIE, now called the Peterson Institute. And I called Fred, but Fred wouldn't talk to me. Fred was too busy for people he didn't know and who didn't have a lot of money. So I went back to Tim Geithner. I said, Fred won't talk to me. I'm quite happy to get his advice, but he said, I'll take care of it. So he calls up Fred. He says, Fred, are you out of your mind? This guy's wandering around trying to give away money, and you won't answer the phone. So Fred answered the phone, and we had a conversation about setting, you know, my vision of what such an institution would be like. And I said, why don't we do a trial balloon? Why don't we do a book about debt? And see where it goes. He said, okay, I'll go off and study the thing. So meantime, I went to Tim Geithner and I said, could you tell me, who do you think would be qualified to run this kind of an institution? So he gave me a list, and it included some people that whose names you will recognize. For example, Susan Rice was on the list. Jeff Lamb was on the list. Nancy Birdsall was on the list. Elizabeth Littlefield, who's here today, was on the list. And it was quite an impressive group of people, and but I didn't know any of them. So, but a friend of mine that I did know from Oxford named Nyree Woods was coming to Washington. She's a fellow at University College, and she's now the head of the Blavatnik School of Government. And Nyree's just one of the A-plus people of the world. That's the only way I can describe her. And she and I were having lunch at the Occidental outside, and I had this list in my hand, you know. Sounds like I'm from the Mikado, you know. I have a little list. Anyway, I gave Nyree the list, and I said, you know, Tim Geithner says these are people I should consider for this job, but I don't know any of them, so let's go through them. And she went through them, and she said, you know, various people, and I won't tell her what she said about the ones she wasn't in favor of. But anyway, we got to Nancy Birdsall, and she said, Nancy Birdsall, she's great. That's someone I would really try to convince to do this. So the lunch ended, and I had a meeting, strangely enough, with Fred Bergsten that afternoon and to discuss this book on debt. So I said to Nyree, I said, would you like to go with me to this meeting with Fred? Well, you know, I thought I could use a little reinforcement. And so we show up at Fred's office on DuPont Circle here before he got his palace on Mass Avenue. And I sit down with Nyree, introduce her to Fred, and Fred says, you know, I've got just the person to run this debt project we've been talking about and write this book. And I said, who's that? He says, Nancy Birdsall. So I had two people within the course of an hour tell me that Nancy was the person. I'm, you know, I'm maybe not the sharpest knife in the drawer, but I got it. I figured we had the person that should do this. And so I got a introduction to Nancy, and we went on, she and John Williamson, began the project. And then Fred never knew that, Fred kind of had it in his idea that he was going to create this little working group within IIE and go do this thing, but that wasn't my idea. I had the idea of what you see here. And so Nancy and I went off for breakfast at the Marriott and talked about our vision of what CGD should look like. And later we got advice from people like Dick Sabat and Carol Lancaster and others. And well, the rest is what you see. CGD needed some financial runway because it was clear to both Nancy and me that you weren't going to, that organizations like this, or frankly any organization, commercial organizations, the thing that distinguishes the winners from the losers is not the market, not the opportunity, not whether there's a trick they have, it's the quality of the people. If you have high quality people, your chances of being successful go up exponentially. There's just no doubt about it. And you're not going to get high quality people if they don't think the institution has, you know, has staying power. And and it was also complicated by the fact that there had been a sort of a think tank that focused on development issues that had gone out of business. So I agreed and provided that runway, and as a result, we were able to recruit the incredibly high-quality team that now makes up CGD. And so you have people like Ruth, who Nancy correctly acknowledged, Steve Radlett, Bill Klein, Lawrence McDonald, Todd Moss, Michael Clemens, Kim Elliott, Amanda Glassman, Charles Kenny, Meadover, and Arvin, whose last name no American can pronounce, but and who disagrees with me about everything, but does so in a very agreeable manner. They're all just a superb crowd. One of the other things Nancy and I agreed on was that CGD would not be a sandbox for economists. In fact, we ought to put that on a plaque and stick it out in the hall. No sandbox. The CGD is about changing things, getting things done, making the world different from the way it is. And in the first draft of the book came to an end, and there was no "and now what" chapter. And we had a discussion about that, and I said, look, you know, we've articulated all these facts. We've talked about some options. Now, what do we want people to do? Well, we want people to do 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Well, we need to say that. And I hope that that notion has become institutionalized at CGD, because to me, it's the essence of what CGD is and ought to be in the future. CGD's had some tremendous successes. The work it's done on AIDS and supporting the Global Fund, a creative immigration scheme for Haitians, the advanced market commitment for vaccines, the Nigerian debt relief project, the helping to reform the African Development Bank, strengthening PEPFAR, creating, in fact, the MCC. That was an amazing thing, the creation of the MCC, because it took place on a conference call that Fred Bergsten, Nancy Birdsall, Bono, Bobby Shriver, and Andy Card, and I don't know if Michael, anyway, there was one other White House person there, talking about what the president could announce at the Monterey conference. And the idea of the MCC came out of that conversation, of rewarding good behavior, rewarding countries that are trying to do the right thing and demonstrate it by their actions. And it was just a tremendous coup for CGD. The support that CGD's given to the rebirth of Liberia. You know, that was way outside the realm of what CGD normally does. This getting engaged directly with a government and trying to help it fix itself. And Steve Radlett led that charge, but Nancy and the rest of the team were very supportive. And I think it's a very bright star in the listing of CGD's accomplishments. Work on modernizing the World Bank and a new scheme for prioritizing public health issues globally. So where do we go from here? Where do we go and where should we go? Well, first, and this may sound like a broken record, I think one of the most important things CGD can do is to crank up, ratchet up in a big way, in every way we can think of, work on improving the status of women and girls globally. And I'm going to say some things just in a very frank way, and if you people don't agree with it, I'm sorry. But I think we've had way too light a touch on that issue. I think that issue requires much more boldness and direct focus. Jimmy Carter has just written a book that he's on the tour with this week called Call to Action, and it's all about that issue. And why we tiptoe around that issue, there's always this, oh, well, we have to be culturally sensitive, you know? I don't buy that. There's certain murder and abuse are not things that you have to be culturally sensitive about, in my opinion. You have to get at it. I think we should have the kind of fervor on this issue that we have as a society when we try to eradicate polio. I mean, we go out there and step by step by step, country by country by country, we work at it until it gets done. And I don't see why we can't do that on this issue. And the companion issue is the whole difficult situation that orphans and vulnerable children find themselves in throughout the world. There's like 145 million orphans in the world and something like 27 million slaves, more than there were 400 years ago at the height of the West African slave trade. Migration, I think, is a huge issue, and I'm going to make some further comments about that in just a second. Another thing that I think is absolutely crucial is finding a way for the governments, the thought leaders like CGD, and the faith institutions to come together. Many, many, many of the issues that hold countries back in the developing world are based on values. They're based on attitudes. They're based on cultural precepts. And the people who shape those most are the faith-based institutions. They're the ones that are permanent in the village or the community or the city. They're the ones that tell people what to think. They're the ones that tell people how to believe, whether they're Islamic, whether it's Jewish, whether it's Christian or Buddhist or of whatever faith persuasion. That's the source of people's feelings about things, and the fact that people can feel it's okay for 10 boys to rape a woman in India, or for women to be stoned to death when they're raped, it's just crazy. And anybody that accepts that as an okay norm because we just have to understand people's cultural preferences has just got their priorities wrong. So I think the role of faith-based... I think, therefore, that more we really need to look at how faith-based institutions, what role they play, and how their impact can be maximized. Many of the faith-based institutions that I've supported have been actually managed and run by evangelical Christians, and that caused my good friend Ruth Levine to jump to the conclusion that I was an evangelical. I said to Ruth, "Don't you recognize an Episcopalian when you see one?" But outfits like World Vision, Catholic Relief Services, Compassion International, Islamic Relief, they're outfits that do stuff that really, really matters, day in, day out, in horrible circumstances, in ways that very few of us would be equipped to emulate. I also think that free trade and sustainable funding for global institutions like the Global Fund are issues that CGD needs to spend more time thinking about. And finally, I think the whole business of global institutions. CGD has written one book that was written by a former foreign minister of Turkey, Kemal Dervish, about global institutions and their effect on development. But I think a lot more work could be done there. The fragmentation of countries and the fact that we just keep having more and more countries trying to each duplicate what the other one next to it's doing, and less regional collaboration, I think, is an extremely bad thing. I think the nation state, before the end of the 21st century, which unfortunately I won't be here to observe, I would like to see the nation state be kind of like Alabama, you know, there but not driving the train. If any of you are from Alabama, I have changed that to Utah or Florida. How about that? In any event, think about it. I don't think it's a crazy idea. So those are some of the issues that I think CGD could think about. Now I'm going to get really crazy on you. What is ahead in terms of process? Well, I think that CGD should lead the charge in trying to embrace some other countries in the global fight against poverty. And I'm going to read my list. Japan, who used to be the number two economy in the world, is now number three, still pretty hot stuff. They've actually started to come around, but not because of us. We haven't influenced them. But my son Reese worked in two NGOs in Japan, one of which distributed wheelchairs all over Southeast Asia for people. And I think there's a lot we could do to strengthen the NGO community in Japan, and should do. Korea, China. You know, people talk a lot about China going out to Africa and, you know, negotiating all these very favorable to itself contracts for resources, and they do that. But, you know, when I was in Liberia, we went out into the bush, and there was a bunch of Chinese military engineers building a road for the Liberians. And we went to lunch with them and talked about what they were doing, and you know, they weren't getting any obvious pleasure out of being where they were, doing what they were doing, but it was a nice thing to see, and I think that should be replicated 100 times over. China's got the money, and we should figure out some creative way to engage them, and we might start with having a senior Chinese person or a Chinese person of wealth on our board. Singapore, India, we're doing some preliminary work in India, but I think, again, maybe we should have a board member from India. Maybe we should try to influence the Indian government. And Brazil. So the nouveau riche, I think, ought to definitely be tasked to get in back of the rock and push it, you know, and not just be observers while we do the heavy lifting, along with, you know, the Scandinavians and the Brits. I mean, there's other people who should take some responsibility for what goes on in the world. And how about the Russians? They've got a fair number of billionaires. A few of them won't be coming to this country anytime soon. But But, you know, time marches on, and I think the Russians ought to be embraced. And what about the Cubans? Cubans have been involved in a lot of international adventures in Africa, all of the wrong kind. Maybe we can get them to go over there with all their doctors and do some good stuff. So those are the kind of things I'd like to see us start to think about, is why not try and, you know, this world is not going to get to be a better place unless we work with each other and understand each other and get to like each other a little bit. What was that, Rodney, the guy that got beat up in Los Angeles, why can't we all be friends? You know, I think that's a very profound statement. And I think that we, the best way people become accepting of others and is if they work with them toward a common goal. That's how people start to learn about each other and get along. So the final idea in the same vein is I think we need greater corporate engagement. You know, there's so many other NGOs trying to do good who are so much better at that than CGD, and I just think CGD needs to fix that. Special Olympics is a very good example, but there are many others. You know, the whole idea of how to do appropriate community treatment of AIDS in Africa came from Anglo-American mining because all its workers were getting sick and it needed to figure out some way to deal with the communities because just fixing the worker wasn't going to fix the problem. And so I think that's a very important thing that we ought to come up with. We ought to put a working group together and come up with a strategy to have further corporate engagement. So I got two more things to say, and I'll stop. The first is, if there was only one thing I could do as king of the U.S., it would be this. I would double or triple the number of student visas. And I would give a green card to every person who came over on a student visa who got a graduate degree. To not do that is insane. Doing it allows people to learn about our culture. It allows people to send remittances home when they get a good job. And eventually, many of those people who stay go back anyway. Look at the Koreans. You know, Koreans in their 40s are flocking back to Korea and setting up businesses and so on. But in the meantime, we've been the beneficiary of that intellectual know-how. And if you look around this room and see the ethnic background and the countries that are represented here, it's a perfect example of what America is all about and the best way to transmit those values. And I think that's why Latin America has been so stable, except for Venezuela and Nicaragua. If you take those two off the shelf, the rest of Latin America has been pretty damn stable because the intelligentsia has been mostly trained in U.S. universities and have a sense of what democracy is all about and have a sense of what, you know, the values of equal opportunity and fairness and a reliable judicial system are all about. So those are my remarks. I have one last thing to say, and that is, you know, I've talked about all the great things we've done, but I want to tell you, it's not about us. It's not about how great we are, what we've achieved. It's about those people out there who can't speak for themselves. A few years ago, I was on a trip with a bunch of other American officials to East Africa, and I actually, that's not true. I was this was a Global Fund trip, and I was in a slum in outside Nairobi, not Kibera, but a different slum. I think it's called Mathare is the name of it. Those of you who know Kenya can probably correct me. But in the course of that visit, I met this gentleman, and you can come up, I'll put it on the table, you can come up, look at this later. This gentleman is sitting in a hut, not much bigger than that table there, in the dark, waiting to die. He's got AIDS, and he almost never sees anybody. Once or twice a day, some women from Kenwa, the Kenyan Women's Association, come and wipe him with a damp cloth and give him some porridge, which has high protein in it, to kind of try and sustain his strength. And he's got no one to speak for him. His whole family died of AIDS, his children, his wife, his brothers. And that was his life, just to sit there in the dark. And it was, I asked him if I could take his picture because I didn't want to offend him and because I wanted to show it to other people. And he said he would not mind that. And he was a very dignified person and he knew what he was in store for, but he received us very graciously in his little mud hut. And that's who we're here to help, people like that, people who can't help themselves. Thank you very much.
So, Ed, I'm under direct orders from Nancy to give you a hard time.
But she knows how to do it.
Yeah. But actually, I thought it'd be more fun to hear you give other rich guys a hard time. And so I want to start with the question of why are there not more Ed Scotts? Why are there not more wealthy people?
The world can't afford another Ed Scott. Too disruptive, but I would say this. I would say that, you know, I could name and shame a lot of people who are a lot more wealthy than I, but that's just would not be productive and I won't do it. But I think that people are afraid. People are afraid that someone's going to cheat them out of their money. People are afraid that they will be looked at as foolish if they spend money on some venture in places, names they don't even recognize, like Zimbabwe or Tanzania or Sierra Leone or other places like that, and then other people in their family say things like, well, there's a lot of things the family needs first, or we've got an awful lot of poverty in the U.S. and on and on and on. And I think the net result is that people become paralyzed and then there are some people who are just fundamentally selfish. I don't know what else. You know, they buy expensive original art, and they have 26 homes, and they want to build a palace for themselves for the ballet or whatever, and have their name plastered all over it. And I feel sorry for those people. And the reason I feel sorry for them is there is nothing that gives you a rush like, you know, effective giving. I got a letter about 2 years ago from a woman who was a Scott Fellow, a Liberian woman, and telling me how I had changed her life. I'd never met this person. And it was a very, very nice letter. And, you know, I look at that letter when I'm feeling bad about myself. And you just get a tremendous rush. 2 months ago, we got a letter from a young man who'd been to my church in Milpitas, California, who we had a scholarship program that was anonymous. Nobody knew who was giving the money. So if someone wanted to write me, they had to write the church, and then the church would send me the letter. And he was saying how he was the only one in his family ever to go to college. And he was now a CPA and had 2 children and just couldn't thank me enough for what I'd done for him. And I had never met him. But the rush you get from knowing that you've really had a personal positive impact on someone's life. Compassion International was observing that a bunch of its children were dying of AIDS and didn't know what to do about it. And I'm not going to tell you the whole story because it's a long, long story. But ultimately, I convinced them, to some extent bribed them, but didn't entirely bribe them, I bribed them to do the seed work, and then they went out and raised the real money for the program. And later, I learned that they had discerned that 12,000 of their children were HIV positive and were getting ARVs. That's 12,000 children that would have died. Now, you don't get, I mean, that makes you feel like, you know, your life hasn't been a total waste. So the people who deny themselves that, I pity them, because it's a very nice thing.
I have to say, you know, I write about a lot of the people who do give. Even among the people who do give, you are unusual for the amount that you've given, the share of your wealth, but also in your understanding of policy and advocacy and the importance of giving to that area. So often when a wealthy person decides they do want to make a difference in the world, they do want to take on global poverty or disease, they want to put their money directly on the ground and more direct service. So I'm interested, how did you come to focus so much on policy, and what can we do to educate more wealthy donors about the importance of investing in places like this?
Interestingly, it was that TV show I watched that really was one-sided in talking about debt, but it made me think, gee, if the impact of this debt with people like, you remember, Nicaragua had a dictator named Somoza, and he went and bought all these U.S. tanks and things, and that's how Nicaragua got in debt. But they weren't the only ones, you know. I mean, all over the world this was going on. And so the light bulb went off in my head that, hey, if you do one thing that has so many tentacles into so many countries, you can really get a lot of leverage. And then when I learned about other issues that were just as important as debt, the whole notion of leverage became very clear to me. There's a very nice fellow who made his money at Charles Schwab, and he runs an institution called Glimmer of Hope, which is a terrific institution. Mm-hmm. And they go around Ethiopia mostly drilling wells and building schools. But, you know, there's a lot of villages in Ethiopia. Yeah. And reaching them all and drilling wells for all of them, building schools for all of them, that's a big lift. And he came to me one day and he said, geez, he said, this is, you know, we really want to do this, but it's really tough. And I said, why don't you use your money to convince the people who can drill a well in every one of these villages to do it, you know? And that those somebodies are the multilateral institutions and the rich countries. Get them on board and you'll get the job done. So that's kind of how it happened. I don't consider myself any genius, because it's pretty...
What did he say?
He said, yeah, I'll think about that. And he went back to what he was doing.
So how can you educate...
He's a very good guy, by the way, so I don't mean to be critical of him, because he's a person I admire very much. I won't say his name. But.
So how to educate? I mean, how do you educate these people? Because there's so much new money coming on the scene.
Well, I got a call the other day, and I won't say who called me, but a person who says she has to give away $10 billion. I said, God, but I'd like to have that problem. but just $1 billion. If I had $1 billion, I could do some good stuff. But anyway, you know, we went through this and talked about it, and she took on board what I was saying. And I'm hoping that she will, and in fact, she's given some money to CGD already. But... That was an example, but I don't want to position myself in this late part of my life as the know-it-all going around telling people what to do. You know, people have to figure it out themselves. I think leading by example and just doing what you can do with what you know how to do is the way to do it, and I think that... the kind of writing you do will be very helpful, because it will expose that issue to people and get them to think about it.
Also, in terms of the question of should they create something new or invest in something that already exists, you chose to create something new here. I'm sure there were organizations that would have been happy to get a, why didn't you write a check to the Institute for International Economics?
Well, that's a very good question. I think some people should. I think the people who don't have the time in their lives to do what I did, because I was theoretically retired. I see my wife rolling over in hysterical laughter. I was theoretically retired, and I could put time into thinking about what next, and being hands-on and talking to people and getting educated by people like Ruth and Nancy. Mm-hmm. Many people can't. So those people should just give money to IIE or somebody else. But if you look at the institutions I've created, they were all because nobody else was doing what needed to be done. There are two people here from Friends of the Global Fight, and I want to acknowledge them. One is Linda Parker, who worked for me for almost, where are you, Linda? Have you gone home already? I guess Linda's left. But Linda was my secretary for almost 15 years at BEA and Pyramid Technology before that. And Friends of the Global Fight was a good example of no one doing what needed to be done. I was at Davos, and I went to hear a speech by Richard Feetchum, who was head of the Global Fund, and Bill Clinton, and a senior vice president at Pepsi-Cola, which is an unlikely trio. But anyway, I listened very carefully, and it became obvious to me that the only support the Global Fund was getting, and Nancy was there at the same time, and we'd had breakfast together that morning, and the only support the Global Fund was getting was from governments, and that individuals and businessmen weren't doing anything to help them. So I went back to my room and got my checkbook, and I wrote a check to Richard Feetchum for $1 million, and I handed it to him. And I said, and he started crying. He said he'd never, ever had anybody do that before. And I said, well, I don't know much about what you do, but it's clear that what you do is crucial to the human race. And so here's some money, which I hope will be an example to other business people and wealthy individuals to support the Global Fund. And he said, well, he thanked me, and again, he was quite emotionally touched. So he went off, and I said, there's one condition, Richard, before you go. And I said, the condition is you must use it for something other than just going out and treating people, putting it into the grant money. It can't just go out into the grant pool. You'll get that from governments. This is for something where you think something's important, but you don't have the money to do it. So Richard went off and thought about it. He finally came back, and we talked about a number of different things. And Bobby Schreiber was being a little helpful in thinking it through. And we came up with the idea that the Global Fund would need a Washington office, because the biggest single donor to the Global Fund clearly was going to be the USA. And if you didn't keep the USA on side, then that money was going to disappear really fast. And so I thought that was just a terrific idea. I said, go for it. That's great. Use the money for that. So he goes back to his board, and he says, this crazy American's given us $1 million, and we'd like to create a Washington office to advocate for the Global Fund and talk to the Congress and talk to other NGOs and talk to public health people and be a center of information flow. And the board of the Global Fund said, absolutely not. We don't need no stinking Washington office. We're a Geneva-based outfit. Go away. And Beecham was just taken by, aback, and he couldn't believe it. So he called me up and told me this story. I couldn't believe my ears. I said, okay, Richard, give me my $1 million back. I'll start the Washington office. So he gave me my money back, and we started Friends of the Global Fight. And I can tell you with great certainty, and that's why the Gates Foundation is so generous to Friends of the Global Fight, that the Global Fund would have run out of money if friends hadn't been covering their back on the Hill. That is absolutely the case. And so that's an example of trying to find something nobody else was doing and that needed to be done and do it.
That is a great example. One more question from me, and then we'll go to the audience. So you're stepping down as board chair. You mentioned in our call that you're 75. I suppose now is the time to improve your golf game and go to the beach. And that's
I'm not going to improve my golf game. I'm going to try and improve my tennis game.
That's what you tell us what you're doing. I know you have a lot of irons in the fire, so it'd be interesting to hear what you have going on next.
You know, I'm involved in about 6 or 7 different commercial ventures, and I won't list them all, but among the most more interesting are a brewery that I have in Florida, Cape Canaveral, which produces about 35,000 barrels of beer a year, and hopefully will eventually get up in the 60 to 100 range. So I can sell it and have some money to do more things, give more money to CGD. I'm also engaged in a startup.
Tell us the name of the beer.
Oh, it's the Florida Beer Company, strangely enough. And it has 3 brands. It has Hurricane Reef, and it has Key West, and then it has a number of different styles under those brands. And it's available here in D.C. If all else fails, go to the Westover Market in Arlington. You can find our beer. We make 2 great IPAs. It's terrific beer. I'm also engaged in a commercial venture that takes tobacco and turns it into ethanol and biodiesel. And that's very interesting and hopefully will be a big winner and be very important impact on the global energy scene. It's going to be a very interesting several years because these people, you know, when you're doing something like that, you're getting right in the way of big oil. Big oil is going to be very happy, and so you need to. I think some of my government experience will have to be brought to bear to fend off the people who wouldn't like to see us succeed. I think those are the 2 things that I'm doing that are probably most kind of fun. and I do own a tennis club that I built. Mm-hmm. I like a lot. I spend all my time there when I'm in Florida. So
so that's great news. You're going to make more money and you'll have more money to give away.
That's the idea.
I'd like to hear that. So we have time for a couple questions from the audience. Yes.
The what?
Increasing the number of visas available to students who would come.
Oh, yes, yeah, visas, right.
And that requires a Congress and an executive to make decisions. Do you see a useful way to use resources to help promote that political objective? And how would you go about it?
Well, I would take the example of the what Friends of the Global Fight did, and that is what every outfit does that wants to educate the Congress on an issue, and that is just go to the staff, go to the members, try and get their attention and walk them through the issues and make it clear why. I mean, student visas are a much better deal than foreign aid, by far. I mean, Haiti's biggest source of income is remittances, and I think so is Mexico's, and Mexico might be number 2 after oil, but it's a good deal for us. You know, self-interest should drive us to do this. And a self-interest story can usually be packaged and told. The thing that I despair about is the Congress is so dysfunctional that I don't know. You know, somehow I'd like to see the president, a president elected that was so popular that the Congress couldn't mess with him or her. and the president could take back his constitutional role in foreign policy
Yes, in the back.
Thank you. Related to that point, would you ever consider writing a big check to a business school in Africa? Just endow one good business school.
I would
call it the Scott School of Business in Malawi.
Well, first place, I'm very opposed to things being the Scott anything, although there have been a couple of things called the Scott thing. But I wouldn't, because I don't know anything about it, and I'm not going to live long enough to learn enough to know how to do it. I would encourage CGD to do some work on the issue and try and get the African Development Bank to fund such a thing. Now that I could get my head around.
Could you just also say your name and institution, too, please?
Hi, Belkacem Nahi from Islamic Relief. I am happy and proud to hear from you today, because I heard a lot of good things in our office from our board of trustees and the CEOs about you. My question is, how do you see the future of the development work in Africa? We know that the growth in Africa is almost between 4% and 5% every year, but we don't see it in the ground. I visited many times Africa. I work on the ground in Chad, in Mali, in Niger, and Burkina Faso. But what's the priorities that we should be tackling now, not in 5 years or 10 years? Is it women development? Is it fighting against malaria? Is it bringing clean water to the villages? Thank you.
Well, I think first place it is all those three things. Getting on top of malaria, which is a very, very doable thing, no doubt about it. Malaria can be licked, and it just takes the will to do it. I think the working on the status of women and is certainly going to be part of it. But I really think the big thing is the educational issue and the free trade issue, so that the way in which the U.S. can help the African countries is to allow them to sell their goods in our country in an unfettered way, and to not have the preferential treatment that we give our own companies when we sell in Africa puts them at such a disadvantage. Bill Klein wrote a very good book on trade that was published by CGD, and it basically talks about that. And, again, this is, if you have a chance to talk to somebody, you can eventually get people to understand that creating economic growth and economic opportunities is in our interest, because then there are people to buy our stuff and we can sell them more of our stuff. And the other problems that plague their society will, in many ways, just take care of themselves. Everybody's last century was obsessed with population growth, and how there wasn't going to be enough food on the planet to feed everybody and so on. And lo and behold, what you observe is as these countries get rich, the problem just evaporates, just goes away. And China's now had to get rid of its one-child policy because they don't have enough, kids being born to take care of the old folks later, as the old folks live longer because the health care is better. And the same problem in Japan. And so I think that, trade is such a key element. And then I think the business I talked about earlier about the student visas, so that you can give people the technical skills and they can go back to Nigeria, they can go back to Liberia. In the Scott Fellows program, I don't know what the number was, Todd. It's like 40-some people. But they were half Liberians from the Liberian diaspora and half other nationalities, mostly Americans, went over there for a year, some for 2 years, to work. The percentage of Liberians who stayed was 100%. 100%. Every single Liberian who went there to work in that program stayed. And those are people who bring in their skills to their country to help the country be a better place.
Let's make this the last question. And
it puts a lot of pressure on me. My name is Frank Wiebe. I'm at Georgetown, actually at the School of Public Policy. I have a couple of admissions. I'm a great fan of the Swamp Ape. I had one last night.
Oh, did you?
And I did indeed.
Holy mackerel, where'd you buy it?
At a little liquor store in Maryland.
Wow.
Yeah, no, it's fantastic.
All right.
Yeah, it's a great Swamp Ape.
Swamp Apes are premier IPA.
That's right. It's fantastic. And I worked at MCC for 6 years, and so I have a connection there, a visiting fellow here. So my appreciations to your contributions through many institutions.
Swamp Ape was the most important.
Which one? But let me ask you, your role on the board, you're now outgoing. I mean, I've never worked directly with the board, but I've seen it more from a staff perspective and how the relationship between management and the board, you know, is...
At CGD?
No, not at CGD, but just generally. Your insights into how you've seen your role and whether you have any advice to incoming people in that role.
Well, thank you. I got it. In the commercial sector in Silicon Valley, board's job principally is to hire and fire the CEO. That's the main job of the board. And also in nonprofits to write decent sized checks periodically or frequently. And CGD's board does not, I'm sorry to say, run CGD. CGD is actually run by the executive committee, which is a much tighter, smaller group of people. And but the board does play a very important role in terms of taking the word out there to people who matter about what CGD does and being willing to do discrete assignments of talking to people on the Hill or doing particular things that need to be done. And boards mostly are crucial in times of crisis when the company's running out of money. I was on a call last night for 2 hours in the middle of the night about one of the companies I'm in significantly invested in that ran out of money. And we had an emergency board meeting last night to approve a Series D financing. So in those situations, boards become very crucial. But, you know, like at BEA, where everything was just great for like 6 straight years, just kept getting better and better and better, board just sits there and does a little calculation of how much their options are worth and don't worry about really much. So that's how I would characterize it.
So, yes.
Someone in the back of the room asked you about the Scott Business School in Africa. Would you be more in favor of a premier business school in Africa, no matter who sets it up, or would you be more in favor of the visa program bringing those African students to the U.S.?
If I only had one choice, I would definitely take the latter.
The latter.
Because I think the visa program bringing kids to the U.S., because I think you touch more people with more different institutions, more different breadth of values and so on. But I would definitely.
So Ed, I want to give you a chance for any closing remarks or thoughts as we wrap up this event.
Well, I feel that all these people showing up today and saying nice things about me is way more than I deserve, and I thank you very much for it. Nevertheless, I'm very embarrassed, but I'm also very pleased that you would do that for me. Thank you.
That's great.
Thank you.